Hi everyone, welcome to Unacademy platform. In this short video, we will discuss 5 most important images from dermatology subject. I am your dermatology educator on Unacademy platform. My name is Dr. Madhuren Srinivas, and you can join my Telegram group. Its name is Crack Derma with Dr. DRMSD. Links will be provided in the description box below. If you have entered Unacademy YouTube channel for the first time, please do hit the subscribe button and join this channel. And these are my classes, these sessions which I have completed. These are free sessions. Links for these I will provide in the description box below, where we have discussed PGI past and AIIMS 2020 July session questions from dermatology subject, and also JIPMER session questions were also discussed. Links for all of them I will keep them in the description box below. And right now there is one capsule course which is going on, which has started from July 21st. It will end till June 21st to June 30th. And yes, these are all the topics which will be covered, and in July the remaining part will be covered. So without further delay, let's start the video. See, please identify what is the possible vitamin deficiency which is responsible for these lesions. So this is a very classical picture. It was given in AIIMS exam, and it was repeated in DNB innumerable number of times. So if you have answered it as B3, that is niacin deficiency, then very good, you have made it correct. So what is this B3 deficiency called as? It is given a name. It is called as pellagra. See, there are multiple causes for pellagra. So, but first of all, you should remember that it is caused because of vitamin B3 or niacin deficiency. And before knowing the causes for the niacin deficiency, we must know how niacin is metabolized or produced, and what are the pathways which are responsible for the deficiencies. Okay, so first I would like to tell that it is tryptophan which is a precursor molecule. After multiple steps, nicotinamide is produced, and this in turn has the activity of vitamin B3. So in the conditions where there is a deficiency of the tryptophan, that is protein deficiency, then there will be reduced precursor molecule, so there will be reduced nicotinamide. So, and also in individuals, populations who have maize as their staple food, also niacin deficiency has been reported. And those individuals who have jowar or sorghum as their staple diet, because of increased leucine content in jowar and sorghum, there is possibility that they may develop niacinamide deficiency. And in yet another condition called carcinoid syndrome, what will happen? Tryptophan, instead of going into this direction, it will be used up in the production of excess of serotonin, that is 5-hydroxytryptophan. So what will happen? Because of this, there will be a deficiency of nicotinamide. So also in Hartnup disease, there is a deficiency of vitamin B3. So how clinically does this present? So you please remember the most important mnemonic, 3 D's, where the first D stands for dermatitis, diarrhea, and dementia. Actually, they say 4 D's. The 4th D is, of course, it is death, which is the final outcome if the patient is not diagnosed and not treated early. So in the dermatitis, what can we see is the most characteristic Castle's necklace. That is the picture which was given in the MCQ. Here, as you can see, there is clear-cut demarcation of the lesion. Over the sun exposed areas, you are able to see the lesions, whereas the sun protected areas are completely free of any skin cutaneous changes. So this can be attributed because this condition is photosensitive condition, where we can see this type of lesion over the V area of the neck, which is exposed to sunlight. So, and that is about the skin changes, and in the systemic changes, what all can be seen is in the GIT, there can be bloody diarrhea, and in the central nervous system, the patient can develop depression or even can go into psychosis. So these are the changes which can be seen. So how do we treat this condition? We replace niacinamide. Niacinamide is better preferred than nicotinic acid. Niacinamide in the dosages of 300 to 500 mg every day. So that's it. That's the first question. So please identify this lesion. This is the second question. So this is the most characteristic image, which is given multiple number of times in various examinations. So this represents what you call as honey-colored crust. So this will represent the honey-colored crust. And can you tell now what is the answer? You should be in a position to answer it as impetigo, because this is a very important image, and they can just give you the image and ask you what is the diagnosis. You should be in a position to answer this only with the help of this diagram, because the impetigo will present with honey-colored crust. And you should remember that it is impetigo contagiosa. It is the most common type of bacterial infection seen in children, and it is non-bullous type. It is caused due to streptococcus more than staphylococcus, and here we can find golden yellow colored crust, which are also referred to as honey colored crust, the characteristic name. And the most important complication, dreaded complication, which is associated with impetigo contagiosa, is post-streptococcal glomerulonephritis, and this is because of the M49 strain, which is responsible, that is streptococcal strain, which is responsible for development of the impetigo contagiosa. And yet another condition is there, which is referred to as bullous impetigo. It is also referred to as P. neonatorum, that is pemphigus neonatorum. Here the organism is Staph aureus, and this Staph aureus will produce epidermolytic toxin, which acts against Desmoglein 1. Please remember, it is Desmoglein 1 only. So what will happen? There will be development of bullous lesions over the skin of the infant, and here in this case the crust is called as varnish crust. And whatever I have explained till now, the lesion will be present only at one or maximum of two, three sites. So this is basically a localized type of bioderma, you can say. The name given to this is bullous impetigo. But if the same epidermolytic toxin becomes generalized, and if it will involve the entire cutaneous surface of the child, then we call it as 4SS, that is staphylococcal scarlet skin syndrome. It is also called as Ritter's disease. Okay, here also the basic pathogenesis and everything is same, except for the difference that bullous impetigo is localized, whereas Ritter's disease is generalized. And in this generalized disease, what will happen? Clinically, we can see sheet-like epidermal peeling can be seen. Okay, and if the bulla are present, then we can elicit Nikolsky sign. And please remember, Nikolsky sign is present in pemphigus, bullous impetigo, but not just bullous impetigo. It should be generalized type of bullous impetigo, that is called as Ritter's disease, staphylococcal scarlet skin syndrome. Okay, so it is positive in pemphigus group of disorders and staphylococcal scarlet skin syndrome. And also we can see Nikolsky's correctly called as pseudo Nikolsky sign. It is seen in SJS, that is Stevens-Johnson syndrome, and toxic epidermal necrolysis. So in these two conditions also we can see Nicole's Kissin, but in them, because it is not due to acantholysis and it is due to necrotic keratinocytes, the preferred term in those two conditions, SJS and TEN, is pseudo Nicole's Kissin. And in the case of the bullous impetigo, what will happen if you observe one single bulla, then you can see that there is pus below and there is air level above. So this is referred to as hypopyonsen. This is given the name of hypopyonsen. So I hope it is clear to everyone. So please try to answer this question. Which dermatological condition shows this type of lesion? So this lesion will be given, and this is so characteristic that there is no necessity for any terms to be given in the question. So this is called as plexiform neurofibroma, and so the diagnosis will become neurofibromatosis. Also, you can see the patient is having few other lesions which are called as neurofibromas, and this sagging of the skin which is seen, this is referred to as plexiform neurofibroma. And please remember that this will have a characteristic feel which is called as bag of worms feel. Okay, I will briefly describe about this neurofibromatosis. Neurofibromatosis, it's a type of phacomatosis, and it is autosomal dominantly inherited, and there are two types which are to be remembered: neurofibromatosis type 1 and type 2. Please remember, type 1 is due to chromosome number 17. You need not butterfly and all, you just try to remember how many letters are there in neurofibromatosis, and if you can just remember this, then you will probably remember what is the chromosome number. And for neurofibromatosis type 2, you can just remember 2 and 2, 22. And here this is because of neurofibromin, and here in this case we will see Merlin and Schwannomann. So what will be the clinical features? So neurofibromatosis, there will be oculocutaneous and oculoneurocutaneous syndrome, we can say, where there will be problems associated with eyes, and also there will be changes, some defects in the skin and also in the central nervous system. So in the neurofibromatosis, come in the skin, what we can see is neurofibromas. The neurofibromas should be two or more, but if it is a plexiform neurofibroma, then even one single lesion is sufficient to diagnose a neurofibromatosis. And these squamous cephalomacules, these are hyperpigmented macules which are seen on the patient's skin, and we can diagnose if they are more than or equal to 6 in number of cum, and they should be of size more than 5 mm in case of pre-puberty and more than 15 millimeters in case of post-puberty, pubertal age group of the children or adults. And yet other lesions are freckles, and the most characteristic and in fact pathognomonic skin lesion, it's given a name, it's called as Crovisen, where there is axillary freckling. You can find the freckles in the axilla. Okay, as I've told, it is oculoneurocutaneous syndrome. So in the eye, what we can see is Lish nodules can be seen. So to visualize Lish nodules, slit lamp examination is needed, slit lamp. So if there are more than two, then you can diagnose it as neurofibromatosis. So like these image based questions, they are very, very important for all examinations, but in the case of FMG, they are very much asking these image based questions off late. So what I would say is you can join the Unacademy for the MCQ marathon which is going on now, and my sessions are scheduled at July 24th, 27th and 28th. Trust me friends, in these sessions I will cover maximum possible image based questions which were asked previously and which are having high possibility or to be asked in the future. So please do join this MCQ marathon for FMGA. It's a batch course. You can join it for subscription of 1 or 2 months. You can use this code if you want. The code is DRMST. If you use this code, you will get an additional 10% off all subscription charges. So, coming to the next question, in which of these cells are Birbeck granules seen? So, these are Birbeck granules. So, you should remember that these Birbeck granules are present in, yes, very good. If you have answered it as Langerhans cells, then you are right. And can you tell me what is the shape of these granules? Yes, you are right. If you have told tennis racket shaped cells, they are having tennis racket shape. And I would just briefly want to mention what are the embryological origin for different types of cells present in the epidermis. So it is maximum keratinocytes which are present ranging from 85 to 90% in the epidermis, but there are also other non-keratinocyte cells like melanocytes, Merkel cells, and Langerhans cells. So Merkel cells are derived from neural crest. Please remember, sorry, I'm sorry, melanocytes are derived from neural crest, and Merkel cells. See, the reason for my confusion was because earlier we learned it as neural crest, and but now in the latest Gray's anatomy, it is given that ectoderm is the most common embryological derivative for Merkel cells. So please do remember this important change which is seen in the latest trend. And Langerhans cells, please remember it is from mesoderm, and these are antigen presenting cells, and they are derived from bone marrow. So antigen presenting cells, and they have these dendritic processes as I have already told Langerhans cells. And on electron microscopy we can see the tennis racket shaped Birbeck granules. And the most important point is in the immunohistochemistry we can see CD1A, CD207 and S100 positivity. But remember the most specific marker, immunohistochemistry marker, is CD207. It is also called as Langerhans. And one more question was asked in the PGA examination. It was asking in which all conditions can you see reduced number of Langerhans cells. So the answer for this is psoriasis, sarcoidosis, chronic dermatitis, and basal cell carcinoma. And you can see in certain conditions the Langerhans cells are elevated, increased. It is Langerhans cell histiocytosis. This H stands for histiocytosis. So in this condition, Langerhans cells are increased. And yet, this is the last question. Please try to answer this question. What is a statement which is true about keratoacanthoma? This was a Jigmer question. And yes, image can be asked. This is so characteristic that even with only image also you must be in a position to answer. So in this case, if you have answered it as molluscum sebaceum, then you are absolutely correct. And I will briefly tell about this, but before that, if you have not joined the Unacademy NEET PG Live Telegram group, please do join that, because this is me who have posted the same question on this group, and there all the 19 subject educators of Unacademy are present in this Unacademy NEET PG Live Telegram group, where almost 3,500 students are already joined. So links for this I will keep in the description box below. So keratoacanthoma, it is given in the question that it is caused by pox virus, but please remember that it is a variant of squamous cell carcinoma. It is not yet sure, but many believe that it is a variant of squamous cell carcinoma. What will be the characteristic is that initially there will be rapid growth over weeks, but eventually it will self resolve and involute over months. So it will grow rapidly in weeks and involutes and in months. It takes time to involute, but it involutes. Okay. The next thing is subungual keratoacanthomas are exception. They do not involute. So here what you can see is this central necrosis is very much common in the case of keratoacanthoma, And because of this, what will happen? The contents will get extruded and it will form an ulcer later on. And since ulcer is a dermal level depth, so there will be scarring. So these lesions will heal with scarring. There are a few syndromes. You please remember Muir Torre syndrome. It is associated with keratoacanthomas, and also there will be immunosuppression or human papillomavirus, which can be associated with keratoacanthomas. And the treatment for this condition is either excision with Mohs micrographic surgery. So that's it for dermatology related images in this video, friends. If you have not yet subscribed to the Unacademy Neet PG live channel, please do subscribe for more of these kind of new image based questions and also MCQ based questions in the coming days. And I thank you a lot for your patient listening. Signing off, I'm Dr. Madhulan Srinivas, your dermatology educator on Unacademy platform. And if you are planning to subscribe to Unacademy for 1 or 2 months, and if you want to see how this platform is, please do try it with using a referral code DRMST. If you use this, you will get 10% off on the subscription charges. So that's it, friends. I thank you so much for your patient listening. Bye.